Welcome to the Hospitality Divas Show by Raj Hospitality and supported by H&M Hospitality Services Delhi and Wanderlust, the number one travel magazine from Delhi again. Our special guest to the show is Ms. Vasudha Soldi. I'm sure that many of you, the viewers, are going to watch her. It's going to be a very, you know, like, I'm excited, but I'm sure that you will be also excited to watch her. I just would like to say a small quote from one of her, I just saw her in one of the magazine what she has done, is that I like that quote a lot. She says that every day is a new day and every challenge is a new. You can never have a boring day syndrome. I think that is something very exciting to me, because I just gone through that interview of yours where you have quoted that. So welcome to the show, ma'am. I'm so happy and delighted to have you to the show today.
Thank you so much. And it's a pleasure likewise.
Our co-host of the day is Geeta Ji, and you're also most welcome to the day, ma'am.
Thank you so much. Welcome to the show, Vasudha, ma'am. So shall we start?
Yes. No, actually, I just like, for all the viewers, I would like to say a few words about Vasudha Ji. She was born in Chennai and educated in Mumbai and New Delhi. She has worked with international hotel companies and held leadership roles. She's the co-founder of Outbound Marketing in 2002 and OM Tourism in 2008. Outbound Marketing. She's an avid traveler. She loves adventures, experiences, and mystery in her travel. She's a woman of grit and substance, and she truly defines what power women are made of. It's something very exciting to, you know, talk about her. Yes, Geeta Ji.
Thank you so much, Vasudha Ji. Thank you, Raj Ji, for such an elaborated introduction about Vasudha, ma'am. So it will be easy for me to ask a few questions now. Ma'am, tell us about your journey from a young mother to an entrepreneur.
Okay, so the journey actually started even before I became a young mother. I became a young mother in the middle of my career. So being the youngest of four siblings, I always had that kind of a streak where I had to follow my siblings, and all of them being achievers, I had to make sure that I was also in a professional space. And my mother was very clear that we all had to have professional studies, a professional degree, and that we had to have a career. So that actually started as soon as I finished my studies in the Hotel Management Institute in Mumbai. So I worked with Taj and then in Mumbai, and then I worked with Taj in Delhi, and then I moved to Hyatt, where actually my training began, because, you know, Hyatt has absolutely fabulous training methods. And then after which I worked for Sita World Travels. And then I worked for the Forte and Le Meridien hotels, and everywhere there was some real solid learning. And I think, in my entire career span, I must have literally changed some three jobs only, giving myself that really strong foundation that I required. And each of these jobs, I think, gave me some insights, which literally sowed the seeds of entrepreneurship. And the company was actually started by my husband, Sanjay Sondi, and he started it in 2002, although he is a doctor of alternative medicine, and he wanted to get into the travel and hospitality space, which he did, and I only joined him in 2003.
That's very nice, very nice. Because I like the generation of her and mine and all that, because the dedication, you know, sticking back with the company to have the strong base is something very exciting. What were the challenges you think that shaped you into the person you are today? What or whom do you think you would like to owe the success?
Regarding the challenges that shaped who I am today, I think the first level of competitiveness for anyone, and I was no different, started with my home. My siblings and my cousins, and you know how Tamil families are, they're always about studies and, you know, achieving and coming first and maths and science and all of that. So I always had, and being the youngest, I always had to keep up with what my other four siblings, three siblings were doing. So I already had that competitive streak in me, and I always wanted to be on top of the game. So I think that in itself was where the first ability to overcome challenges was sown. And then I planned to be in the hospitality business right from when I was in my eighth grade. And so I really worked hard to get into the institute, because, you know, at that point, the institutes were very far and few between. There was just, there were just two institutes in Mumbai, one which was run by Tangam Philip in Dadar, and one which was the Sophia College. And I wanted to get into the institute which was run by Tangam Philip because I had heard her in my school. So that's really, that was the first challenge that I had to overcome. And after which I, you know, at Taj, it was just training. But when I really joined Hyatt and I got into the banquets, banquets and conferencing is immensely hard work. It is being on your feet for 16 to 18 hours a day sometimes. It is to take decisions, spot decisions. You don't have an opportunity to say, I'm going to go and check with somebody and come back to you. It is an ability to think on your feet and act on your feet. So these are all great learnings at such a young age. You know, I was in my early 20s. After Hyatt, when I joined Sita World Travels, and under the visionary leadership of Mr. Inder Sharma, I learned about international markets, still in my 20s. And I learned about you know, communication skills, saying the right things at the right time. And I got great exposure on the other side of the business, because I, after I joined Sita, I felt somehow that, you know, being in the hotel business, one had a very narrow perspective of things, especially at that level that I was. But once I went into Sita and I, you know, traveled the world and I met different people, the horizon kind of really broadened. And after that, I also dabbled in setting up a representation company. And then I got into Forte and Le Méridien Hotels. And that was a leadership role. And there I had to show some really swift learning curve. It wasn't easy dealing with owners of hotels. And at the same time, I was responsible for delivering revenue to our international hotels from the source market, mid-90s. And I was in my early 30s. And so again, I learned to prioritize because I had a very small team. So if you see, you know, in my early days of maybe 10 years career span, I had learned decision-making. I had learned to think and act on my feet. I had had great exposure to international market, and I learned to prioritize. I think those challenges really helped me shape up. In terms of, you know, who my mentors were and who really helped me reach where I am today, I would definitely first say it was my parents. Because through their actions, I learned that integrity was something that you didn't take lightly. Hard work, the motivation to keep gaining knowledge. My mother always used to say that readers become leaders. And you know, I keep saying that to my team now, and they're very bored of that saying. But anyway, and then I think Mr. Inder Sharma was definitely one of my mentors, definitely Ms. Tangam Philip, who really shaped a lot of the way how I think today. And also my husband's family, because without their unstinted encouragement and support, I couldn't have brought up two children, had a home, and had a career.
Thank you. Geeta ji.
So, yeah, I read that you believe self-discipline, self-training shapes a person today and for the future. Can you just elaborate your thoughts?
Hello.
So all of this points to the fact that you have to live your life, you have to prioritize. If you don't prioritize, you know, you're not really going to get where you want to get. And in the day and age of immediate satisfaction, of plenty, discipline helps one prioritize. And an organization can train its team only up to a limit. A person has to self-train. You have to go beyond the ordinary. Your organization has taught you so much, but you then try and go that extra mile. You try and observe. You learn by observing. And you also learn. And in today's day and age, you have to unlearn and learn. So all of this is squarely up to the person, up to the individual to do.
My question to you is that since you have been in the foray for outbound marketing, what is your take on the travel and tourism getting back on its feet? Do you expect things to get normal, especially the international tourism?
Okay, so, you know, yeah, of course, there is no question of if the tourism is going to be back. It's only a question of when it is going to be back. And there is no doubt that it will be back. But it definitely is going to take time. We have to be realistic about this. Writing is on the wall. And you know, tourism has started already. If you look at the domestic tourists traveling out into the country, you can really say that there are people who are eager to travel, which is great. And I'm sure once the international airlines start, international travel will also start. But, you know, more important than this, the question is, after such a hard knock that 2020 has given us, where people have been without livelihood, our industry has been affected, and like other industries have been affected, have we really learned a lesson? Are we really looking at a sense of responsibility as an industry? I'm not even talking about the traveler now. I'm really just talking about the industry. We are so desperate for business that we are willing to sacrifice health and hygiene and safety just to take in the people. Is that right? Is that a point of responsible tourism? I just want to give an example. You know, I'm right now in Mukteshwar and I'm seeing tourists out in the open and I'm horrified to see that nobody is maintaining physical distancing. They don't have their masks on. The only people I see with the masks on are the locals. So is this what domestic tourism is going to do to a country? Is it going to again take us back to another wave? These are all really serious questions. And I think that resorts and hotels, just like airlines are toying with the idea, resorts and hotels also need to be able to say that you guys test yourselves and come, get a negative report and enjoy yourself at the resort. Let us be safe. Let the staff be safe. Let the village be safe or let the you know, resort destination be safe. And I think that's the way to go about it.
Right. So you work with various international tourism boards. Do you think Indian tourism should take note of any aspect of travel that other international boards have considered?
So the ministry is doing some good work, Geeta, I have to say that, you know, especially in the past couple of years. And you know, they are taking, they're making good policy decisions, and I'm sure it's going to get us a good tourists in years to come. And I would really say that at the state level, I think the policy making has to be a little sharper. I would really say, I would talk about two things. One is cleanliness and waste management. And I think cleanliness and waste management is something that is the need of the hour. Sure. And I think state can definitely mandate that. There are companies that make waste management machines. And I think our tourism, state tourism machinery has to really look at that, number one. Number two, I would say that in environmentally sensitive zones, we have to really show responsibility. You know, a couple of months ago, there was an article of a 2,000 person's wedding in a hill station in an extremely biodiverse and environmentally sensitive zone. And I think some 20 tons of waste was left over there. Now tell me, is this something that augurs well for tourism? You know, if you go to, for instance, to Switzerland or Austria or any of, I've been going there for 20 years and I haven't seen that kind of construction and, you know, massive hotels coming up like the ones that we have here in our really sensitive hill areas. Or, for instance, I mean, look at what happened to Goa or what happened in Garhwal. You know, have we learned from those incidents? Have we learned our lessons? It seems not. In Kumau, a hotel has come up with 300 rooms 2 years. And tell me this, I mean, there's a paucity of natural resources here. Who takes these decisions? So these are all things that I think we really can do with learning from some of the international destinations who are doing very well with tourism and who are able to preserve their tourism product for generations to come.
Thank you. Right. What are the criteria you look for in a client business for you to assist them with sales and marketing solutions and ensure the ROI also?
Okay, so I'm not sure I understood the question, but I mean, let me try and answer it. So the criteria that we look for in a product, that it shouldn't be like a square peg in a round hole, you know, but literally any tourism product can be marketed in India. I think the challenge really is in finding the right target segment or the right audience. And we as an organization have always underscored our work by saying that we put sales back into the representation business. So we are very, very conscious of driving up revenue or ROI. And that's really what we are good at.
I think it's a perfect answer. Geeta ji.
So what are your current service offerings? And I understand that you are stepping into a small retreat, immersive experiences. Can you just tell us more about that?
Okay, so our current offerings are, of course, continue to be sales and marketing, and which includes digital marketing. We also offer media services such as PR and influencer marketing, and we're doing this for a variety of clients. And we are currently working primarily with international, but we also work with a few domestic properties, and you know, just properties that need maybe help with revenue management or things like that. Very specific projects that we work on in the domestic market. And we're also working with national tourism boards, and we do projects with state tourism boards as well. So this is in a nutshell what we're doing. And from a PR side, we are also working with non-tourism clients and for digital marketing. And we also do end-to-end branding solutions. So this is, in a nutshell, our service offering. As regards a retreat, 2 years ago, we opened our yoga retreat in Uttarakhand. And this was in a fruit orchard that Sanjay and I own. And you know, we're running it. And that's where I am at the moment. And, you know, I've been hiding here since June. And actually also working. We are opening another one in Ramgarh next year, and currently we've actually tied up with a leading boutique homestay provider for them to handle our sales for this particular retreat. But I also want to talk about something else that we are building up, and which is our charitable foundation called Annapurna Charitable Foundation. And we have done small projects mainly, but the one I would say medium-sized project that we did was in Uttarakhand itself, in the village Pioda, where we partnered with another NGO and with Meridian New Delhi to set up homestays in the homes of villagers. So we set up actually 13 homestays, and Meridian helped us in the training and in 1 year handholding. Because once you train, you've got to go and check if they're following all those standards and things. So they did the audits also. They were fabulous. You know, a team of four persons traveled each time with me. Three, four times even Meena traveled herself with me to this village. And we did a lot of activity there. We actually helped them also with setting up the room, how to maintain it, what to do before a client checks in, checks out. I mean, the whole nine yards. And then towards the end of it, we helped them set up a cooperative with the help of Uttarakhand Tourism. And now they're pretty much running the business themselves. So that was one really good project that we did. And then more recently, after the cyclone had struck Ampan in West Bengal, Annapurna Charitable Foundation adopted one of the villages in District Haldia, and then we helped build it up. And the project is just kind of finishing. It's on its last legs.
Thank you. Youngsters today, especially the women, the young girls, I would like to say that. What you would like to advise them, or maybe give them some tips to see that they sustain and maybe become someone like you tomorrow?
Oh, I'm sure, I don't want to be a role model in that sense, because again, I go back to my dear late mother, and she would always say that, you know, you've done very little of your capability. So I'm under no illusion. I mean, I've done what I think I could have done. But I'm sure the youngsters of today can really, really achieve a lot more. My message to them really would be, dream big with your eyes open and have the strength, energy, and determination to go after it. And before you reach it, you have a plan in place, prepare for it. Because once you achieve your dream, you've got to keep it as well. And the difficult part is keeping it if you're not prepared.
Thank you. They say actually make your life a masterpiece. Imagine no limitations on what you can be, have or do. So that's what Vasudhaji has advised. And I'm sure the young woman or maybe the young girls will take a lot from this interview. Thank you, Vasudhaji. Geetaji?
Thank you.
Yeah, thank you so much, ma'am. So a great man once said, your positive action combined with positive thinking results in success. With that note, I would like to thank you, Ms. Vasudhaji, for discussing about your challenges, putting light on the idea of self-training and taking a fore in the outbound marketing. We really appreciate it, and we hope you succeed in all your future endeavors. Thank you so
much. Thank you, my dear, and I wish you the same.
Thank you, Ra.
Thank you.
Bye-bye.